Is liberty dying where you live? Escape to Keene at freekeene.com.
To the three speakers, they're going to speak in panel style, and then afterwards you are, not required, you are encouraged to ask any question that has to do with politics, government, that you would like to. So Ean Freeman, this young man, is the co-founder of Free Talk Live. He's also one of the Robin Hooders in Keene, and he's run for office. Representative Mark Warden is from Goffstown. He's a Republican, and he's also a real estate agent. And Garret Ean is one of the Robin Hooders. He's run for state rep in Concord and actually helped to defeat a 26-year veteran. So you can do something when you're young. He was only 18 when he did it, and he's also one of the Robin Hooders. So I'm going to turn it over to the three gentlemen.
Thank you, everybody, for coming out. And hopefully we're going to just, I guess, do some introductory speaking briefly and open up to questions. So if you guys have anything you want to ask at some point, we'll put the microphone out there and you can ask whatever you want. So I'm Ean Freeman. As she mentioned, I host a talk radio program called Free Talk Live. It airs 7 nights a week. You can go to freetalklive.com and you can download episodes, listen live, etc., things like that. I got involved in kind of the movement for freedom back when I was a teenager. I learned probably when I was around your age that I was being lied to by the people that call themselves the government. And turned out they were lying about a whole lot of stuff. One of the big things that was a real eye-opener to me was the war on drugs, which I see as a war on our friends and family members. And that's exactly what it is. And that kind of opened up this door to me where I found out that they were telling me all kinds of lies and misinformation. And then I discovered that not only were they lying, but they were also hurting people. You know, peaceful people, people like you, who haven't hurt anybody else. You know, these folks are being, our neighbors and our friends are being arrested. They're being put in jail cells, and they've never harmed anybody else. And so I just really got upset about that, and I wanted to do something about it. So I started to learn more about what freedom really is. And what I learned was that liberty or freedom means that you should be free to live your life how you want, so long as you don't hurt anyone else. And if you hurt somebody, well, then something should be done about that. But as long as you don't, you know, steal from somebody or physically harm someone, then you should be free to live your life how you want. And that's the philosophy that I live by. It's a philosophy that I want other people to understand, and hopefully we can express some of that here today. So that's kind of a little bit about me and how I got into the activism movement. I actually wasn't born in New Hampshire. I was born in Florida, and I moved up here as part of the Free State Project. Ms. Ean mentioned that Mark is a Republican. I'm a registered Democrat, although I'm certainly more of a libertarian. It's just that in New Hampshire, you have to pick one party or the other. Definitely love the ideas of freedom, and I'm really glad you all came out to listen today.
Thank you. Damas y caballeros, bienvenidos. Gracias por venir hoy a nuestro concurso para platicar de la política. So that was a nod to the Spanish class here, but welcome. My name is Mark Warden, and as mentioned earlier, I'm a state rep. So I'm a legislator in the New Hampshire State Legislature, representing the towns of Goffstown, Ware, and Deering. And I'm now in my second term. So I am sort of your non-traditional legislator in that I don't follow the party line, and I often vote against what other Republicans are standing for or would say, and vote against what some of the Democrats are voting for. So I consider myself anyway a very independent thinker and actor in the legislature. So we're going to talk about a number of things today, including things outside of the political spectrum, but my purpose here is to talk about what we can do within politics, within government, at least on the legislative side of government, to provide more freedom and less government control of your lives. So one of the things you wonder is, how does it apply to you? And you're thinking, heck, I can't vote yet, right? Most of you guys aren't even legally old enough to vote. Well, the fact is that the government is spending your future income today. They're making promises and buying off favors today that come due tomorrow when you guys are in your working years. Not only you folks, but your children, and perhaps their children now have debt the day they're born because of what's going on in Washington and in some of the state capitals. So it's another reason to think about politics and how it's going to affect you, and maybe you'll have a say in educating others, your peers, perhaps even your parents, on why more government in your life is not necessarily a good thing. Unlike these guys, I got started sort of late in life, and that wasn't until my mid-30s before I even started paying attention to politics, so it's never too late.
Well, thanks for coming down, everyone. My name is Garrett, and I grew up in Concord. I like what Mark said about, and Ian said about, how when you see things that you want to change in the world, there's kind of the prescribed system that politics is supposed to provide, where one is allowed to go in, voice their position, have someone who claims to represent them vote on that issue. But there's also more that one can do that's outside of that structure. And for me, that's what's caught my attention in the past few years and been what I have pursued. Out of high school and college, I ran for state rep a few times. That's a great way to get started with promoting a message, spreading ideas with people, because you do get lots of free airtime from it. But there's other projects that one can do if they get involved with their friends and their communities that one can self-start that I think can make a major impact and change things even in better ways than the prescribed system allows for. So in Keene, New Hampshire, where I've been living about the past year and a half, there's many individuals who are active with different police accountability organizations. There's a number in the area, and we'll go out and just record the police making an objective record. And I'd say, to a large extent, that's forwarded the conversation of responsible community policing. I actually happen to have a background in schooling in law enforcement. That's what I got a degree from the university I attended. And like politics, where there's a prescribed system for changing things, the criminal justice system in a similar way is something that if one sees problems with it that they want to change, you could either get a job within that system and try and change the system from within, or you could work outside of that system and try and build a new framework or a new alternative for how you'd like to see things done. So another thing I was just involved in at the past month is I was on the police accountability tour with my friend Pete Ayer. And we were going around the country to different cities, checking with local activist groups and seeing what the status on this ground was, whether it came to crime or police brutality or police accountability issues. And it was very eye-opening to see that each place has their own issues and their own challenges facing it. I think here in New Hampshire, we're very privileged to have pretty safe communities, pretty low crime rates, and pretty low rates of police brutality from at least relative to some other areas of the country. Another project that I'm also involved with in Keene, it involves video cameras, is Robin Hood of Keene, which is where myself and my friends, sometimes Ian will come out with us, we'll fill up parking meters so that people don't get parking tickets. That's a way in which one can very easily and effectively prevent this penalty that people shouldn't really have to suffer. It seems like an annoyance more than anything, parking tickets. For just a nickel, you could save someone $5 or even more than that. So that's, I'd say, a really effective way that individuals can just get together and make changes to the way that things are done. Myself, Ian, and four of our friends won a lawsuit recently that the city of Keene had filed against us. Basically, they didn't have any foundation for the lawsuit, and the judge threw it out because they can't claim that just filling parking meters is against the law or illegal or harassment or anything like that. So, I don't know where we want to go from here.
Well, it was actually two lawsuits that we won. The city of Keene, I also live in Keene, and the city of Keene, which is really just a group of men and women who force their way upon people through the threat of violence, they came after us with these lawsuits to try to stop us from going out and saving people from getting parking tickets. We did not stop, even though the suit happened and it took several months for it to all play out. The Robin Hooders, as we're called, continued on the streets, continued saving people from getting parking tickets. In Keene, estimates are that we've saved at least 5,000, maybe even as many as 8,000 people from getting parking tickets. Now, I don't know how many of y'all are old enough to drive? Old enough to drive? Okay. Have any of you gotten a parking ticket before? Okay, a few of you. How does it feel when that happens? It feels pretty awful, right? So if you can stop somebody from getting a ticket, then you can make someone's day. Because what we do is we leave little cards, and we've actually brought some of them here.
Oh,
they're
on our table in the back.
Oh, they're in the back? Okay. So you can actually see the Robin Hood card. There's a picture of Robin Hood on it. On the back side, it says, your meter expired, but we saved you from the king's tariff. And then it gives some donation information so you could send, you know, some money to help us buy more nickels to save more people. Anyway, you can take a look at that when you get a chance. But the city was actually accused, the city attorneys and folks that work for them were accusing us of harassing, intimidating, and threatening their employees. Now, I mean, I'm not really an intimidating looking guy, so I'm not sure where that came from, but they essentially wanted to make up this story about us to try to make us look like bad people, when what we're really doing is out there saving people from getting parking tickets, and they wanted to, they wanted the people in the area to believe what they were saying about us, you know, considering that most people haven't met us, they don't know us individually, so they just believed that, oh, well, we're out there threatening their employees. And it was absolutely ridiculous. When we went to trial, there was 3 full days in court where the city attorneys had plenty of opportunity to provide evidence of the supposed threatening and harassing that was going on, and they didn't, because they didn't have any evidence like that, because we're peaceful people, and we want to see more peace in the world. And it doesn't seem like the political system is a real effective way of doing that, and so I can understand why some of you might be pretty frustrated by maybe whatever you've observed with politics, because it seems like Republicans and Democrats, they just want to control you. They just want to tell you how to live, and if you don't do what they say, well, then you get to go to a jail cell, which is somewhere I've been, by the way. Even though I was mentioning earlier that, you know, I was talking about how the government people hurt other people who've never harmed anyone else. I've never hurt another individual ever, but I've spent 60 days in a jail cell. And that's because I stood in front of a police car in Keene as they were about to, they were arresting a friend of mine. She was enjoying her afternoon in the park at Central Square in Keene, right in the heart of downtown Keene. She was enjoying her afternoon. She had an open container, and I had said that I was going to stand in front of the police car the next time I saw them arresting somebody who had never hurt anybody else. She didn't hurt anybody. Nobody had complained about what she was doing in the park that day. There was no victim. Except for her. She was the victim. The police made her into the victim, because otherwise she was just enjoying her afternoon until they came along and they started threatening her, and then they started dragging her away. So I stood in front of the police car, and so did 3 other people. We all got arrested for it. I was convicted of obstructing government administration. I was, and that was a jury trial, so I went to trial, and then I went to jail for 2 months. I've been arrested 6 times, I think, and all of those times, not once did I ever hurt anybody. They were all for victimless crimes or non-cooperation and civil disobedience. So civil disobedience is something I have a lot of experience with. It's something that I find a very, very powerful thing to do. It brings a lot of attention to different issues. And if you visit my website, which is freekeen.com, Garrett's also one of the bloggers at Freekeen, there's a lot of information about a whole bunch of things that we've been doing over the years there in Keene that might be of interest to you, so.
Yeah, I'd like to speak on the civil disobedience angle. Ian talks about how he made the decision to put himself on the front line, so to speak, and choose to get arrested in the sense of sitting in front of a police car when the police tell you not to. That's going to result in some action. I myself have also seen the inside of a holding cell, fortunately not a jail cell, but I was arrested at a protest in Manchester along with 8 other people, 9 total. Simply for being at the protest. It went on about 2.5 hours. Some people had chalked, and they were arrested for chalking, which some of that got thrown out, some of it got upheld. But at the end of the day, myself, a few other people were arrested for not moving fast enough from an order to move. So it's if you go out and you put yourself out there and if you choose to chalk a message on the sidewalk, which is totally legal, if you choose to hold a camera near a police officer, totally legal, you're still introducing yourself to some amount of potential resistance. Fortunately, things are changing because police are getting more used to the fact that individuals are allowed to and protected in the sense that they're recording or documenting public activity. But you are, without trying to, you can still get arrested, you can still get caged, and you can still have to go to trial. But myself and my friends, we worked together on the particular case I was facing with the Manchester arrest. We had practice trials, mock trials. I took mock trial in high school, and I felt that really helped prepare me for court in real life. And when you can't expect justice from the legal system, there's a large restriction on information, but you can make sure that you get all of your information out there, that the public record is the entire case that you want to make for yourself. The internet is an incredible tool for this. A video camera is an incredible tool for this. The ability to just speak freely and post freely is something that allows you to control the frame if and when the state or some organization is reacting to information that you're putting out there, a perspective that you're putting out there. So civil disobedience, I think, is great. I encourage people who feel compelled to do it to do it. But it's not something that I'm personally involved with or doing, because I feel that I will get enough reaction from the authorities just by offering my constitutionally protected resistance to their activities. As we've seen with the Robin Hood case, now fortunately that was thrown out, but it was still a grueling 3 days in court that myself and Ian, four of our friends, had to sit through. And all in all, it was a lot of fun, but
Well, it was especially fun when we got Fox News, MSNBC, Good Morning America, all kinds of news coverage that we otherwise would not have gotten for doing this Robin Hooding thing of saving people from getting parking tickets. When the city sued us is when all of a sudden this thing went viral. I mean, it was all over the place. And a lot of people say viral and they don't really know what that means. This thing really did. It was all over the news. And we literally got millions of dollars in free press coverage for what we're doing in Keene. And if it weren't for the city aggressing against us with this lawsuit, we never would have gotten that level of coverage. So we actually sent them flowers to thank them for that.
Let me ask you guys what you think of the notion that courts are always unbiased and that you can get a fair shake and that the justice system works, because that's what we're taught in school, in civics class, that the judges are neutral, you know, they don't take a position, they never make a mistake. You guys have had more experiences with this than I. What sort of information would be a good takeaway for these young people to learn about that process?
We've seen judges make decisions against us and then have those same decisions overturned. The courtroom is not the place where one can expect to get the full story and the full facts. It's where there is the public investment in what is the final outcome. But of course, the final outcome of any case isn't everything, especially if we looked at major cases that have been in the news nationally, like the Trayvon Martin case, for example. How many people will still believe that Zimmerman is either guilty or not guilty? It's not really based on what the jury says. So to a large extent, I'd say that you're restricted from sharing information in the court system. There's an order by which you must present information in the court system. These are things that attorneys know that regular people don't ever need to know. In the case in Manchester where I was arrested, I did represent myself and I successfully defended myself against those charges, but it did require hours and hours of research. The system is intentionally complicated, complex. There's a reason you need to go to school for like 4 years to get a law degree and to even understand it. And I think that's unfortunate. But what I do think can help people understand and maybe bring more sense to that system is more of our own in-depth analysis and investigation into what exactly it is they're doing, continuing to get information from the courts when they do make decisions. We're going to be going over this Robin Hood decision in depth to see what exactly it is, since it is unprecedented that the court is alleging one is permitted to do under the guise of the First Amendment. You can't trust the court system to get everything right. That's why I think it's important that when one has a perspective, they express it independent of any one particular system. And I make sure that you make a record of your own story and put it out there for people.
Yeah, so when you're in court, almost everyone except for you is working for the state. Now, the state is an idea, and it's a really bad idea. It's an old idea, but it's one that people are very familiar with. They're brought up with, we're in a state-run school right now. And the state is just, basically, it's a group of men and women, as I suggested earlier, who believe they know what's best for you, and they're gonna tell you what they think is best for you. And not only are they gonna tell you, but they're gonna demand that you do what they say. And again, if you don't do what they say, even if you aren't hurting anybody else, you might go to a jail cell. But first, you go to court. And when you're in court, they like to claim that they're this unbiased organization, but who pays the judge? The state. Who pays the prosecutor? The state. So everybody in that courtroom, except for your defense attorney, who, by the way, has sworn an oath to the court system, is working for the state. So right on its face, there's a conflict of interest right out the gate in the courts. But unfortunately, it's all we have. So you make your best case that you possibly can. Now, Mark, you're involved in the legislature, and there's obviously a lot that goes on there. But are the people in the legislature, you've spent a few years there now, are these people who care about freedom?
That's a very good question. And the short answer is not all of them, perhaps not even most of them. What happens in New Hampshire and about everywhere else is that pretty much anybody can get elected to state office. And that's nowhere truer than here in New Hampshire. So you have, first of all, people who are part-time legislators, many of whom are retired. There's no background check. There's really no qualifications needed other than getting yourself elected. Once you're there, we find out that people have all sorts of personal motivations, personal biases about government. And a lot of people who go into government at the legislative branch are sort of pro-state, pro-government. So they think their duty is to go to Concord and think of more laws to control people's behavior. It's almost the default, from the get-go, it's the default opinion of what they think they should be doing there. I take a different tack. I think I should go in there and repeal a lot of the laws. There are more laws on the books than anybody could ever know. Frankly, somebody does something illegal every day without knowing it because there are so many laws on the books.
That's a great point. How could you even read them all?
You can't. It's impossible. And the way it works is, first of all, you pass all these laws, and then the departments and agencies of the state are assigned with making rules and regulations to support those underlying statutes. So there's another hornet's nest or a myriad of rules and regulations that nobody can ever know about. So the problem is that each time there's a new regulation, it in a tiny way reduces your personal freedom. So the three of us like to say that if you're not harming anybody else, if you're not stealing from them, if you're not punching them in the nose, if you're not defrauding them, then people should be left alone to act honestly and fairly and peacefully with one another without the government's intervention. So that's my mission in the legislature, is to point out we need more freedom, not more regulation of people's lives.
I don't know if Ms. Ean, I don't think you mentioned this, but Mark here is actually the legislator of the year as awarded by the New Hampshire Liberty Alliance, and he's done it twice. Was it 2 years in a row?
Yeah, two out of 3 years.
Two out of three years, which means that the New Hampshire Liberty Alliance is an independent organization that looks at all the voting records of all the 400 state reps here in New Hampshire, and they grade them, A through F. They grade them on how good they are on voting for more freedom. And Mark has gotten the A-plus rating 2 out of 3 years, and making him the number one. So congratulations on that, and thank you for your dedication. We can open up to questions anytime. If y'all have questions or you know something you want to know more about, feel free to raise your hand. I'm going to walk over with the microphone, and then we'll see what we get.
Hi, I'm Jared, and I was wondering, would you guys support the change in the style of government from a republic to a pure democracy, where pretty much you get like all the people who live within the town or whatever and have them vote instead of have them elect individuals to vote for them?
Okay, that's a good question, Jared. Thanks for your question. In general, the answer is no. I support the idea we have now of what's called a representative republic at the national level. I'm more of a representative form of government and not a pure democracy. There's an old joke that says an example of democracy is two wolves and a sheep voting on what's for dinner. Yeah. Have you heard that? Uh-huh. Right? So all it takes is a majority, 50% plus one, to decide what all 100% of a society have to do. That's a very dangerous way to go. And unfortunately, people get involved emotionally and with their heart instead of their head when a lot of these decisions are being made. And it's nice to have a couple buffers between just a pure plebiscite or pure democracy.
Well, I think that question raises some other good questions about how exactly systems are structured. I'm not a fan of majoritarianism, the idea of 50% plus one being able to make decisions. I think things should be as decentralized as possible and as self-empowering as possible. But I would support a more democratized system of governance that people could voluntarily adopt. If anyone's been to an Occupy New Hampshire event, it's been a while since there's been one, but they ran on a consensus model, probably not a true consensus model because that usually means total agreement, but the model that they would consider to be consensus for group movement would be around 70 to 80%, depending on who was at the General Assembly at that time. But I thought that was a much better model, and if I could have snapped my fingers and replaced the state of New Hampshire government with an Occupy New Hampshire General Assembly, I think it would create a much simpler process in as far as what is actually turned into legislation. Maybe it would be more hectic in the short term as there's more people able to speak on more matters. But yeah, I think just the idea of moving away from a system where fewer people control larger numbers of people is always a good direction to go in, and people should have more control of themselves at their home with their families, their roommates. That's where most of the decisions for people's lives should be made.
Yeah, I tend to agree with Garrett on this. The idea of democracy and republics, these are old ideas. And they're the ones that you get taught when you're in school, which of course makes sense because, well, the school's run by the state, which is also a really old idea. I think that I like the idea of decentralization. The state is kind of a centralized organization. And I think that if we can get into, as Garrett touched on, consent, I think the issue of consent is really key, because in the system that we have today, whatever you want to call it, some people will call it a democracy, other people will say, it's a republic. You know, they'll argue about that forever. But what we have is a group of people forcing their will on others who may not necessarily agree with it. And if you don't consent, then you're being threatened to do things against your will. And I don't appreciate it when people threaten me. I don't know about you, but it doesn't feel good. So I think.
So one other thing we need to remind ourselves is that the rights of the individual and of the minority always need to be maintained.
Well, that's what they say are supposed to happen in a republic, right? I mean, that's, you've got the Bill of Rights, for instance, and there's some good ideas in there, but a lot of them have just been completely ignored. The people who call themselves the government just seem to do whatever they want to do, and then every now and then they get called on breaking their own set of rules. So if people were to consent to a democracy, then I would support that. But if somebody doesn't consent, I don't think they should be forced into it. That's my position on it. Anybody have any questions at the moment? Otherwise, we can keep talking about other things that we might do. Something else I do is outreach projects. And as Garrett mentioned, there's some flyers at the back. We brought a few of them with us today. We've got a whole bunch more. One of them is don't take a plea deal. And we've talked a little bit about courts already. This is something that I just did yesterday. We do it on a regular basis in Keene, where they have arraignments. An arraignment is where you get charged, when you've been charged with something, you have to go to court, stand in front of a judge, and the judge asks you, how do you plea? And then, you know, usually say guilty or not guilty. And so the system that we have here today is built on the plea deal process, which is a very detrimental thing. It's very bad. Plea deal means that you get charged with something, let's say underage possession of alcohol. You get charged with something, and then they come at you and they say, well, look, you could go to jail for a year on this. How about this? You plead guilty. We'll make it so you don't have to spend any time in jail. You'll be on probation for 3 months. You have to check in with a judge, and you'll have to pay a $300 fine. And of course, most people will say, guilty. Because, you know, they don't want to go back to court, they don't want to risk the possibility of going to jail. And court's a scary experience. It's an intimidating thing. The first time I was in court, I was so nervous. I'm a little bit better at it now because I've been so many times. But the purpose of not taking the plea deal would be to not make it so it's easy for them. When you take a plea deal, they don't have to make a case. They don't have to go to court. There's no trial. You've already taken the plea. It's over. You're agreeing to pay them. So not only are they not working to get a conviction in your case, but they're also getting cash from you as well. They're getting a lot of money. In fact, if you ever take the time, it's usually during the school day, so probably not going to work for you, but someday when you get a chance, go sit in an arraignment and watch what happens. It would make for an interesting field trip, actually, a real eye-opening experience, because I can tell you that when I go to Keene District Court and I look at the people that are coming into that room, a lot of them are just a little bit older than you are. You know, they'll arrest college students for underage drinking constantly. Keene's a college town. So, I mean, literally, there's 18, 19, 20-year-olds constantly just being paraded through the court system. And somebody was sitting in there one day, they counted 27 students come through, take a plea deal, and all racked up like $400 a piece in fines. The court raked in something like $10,000 in just a 3-hour morning period. Now, where's that money go? $10,000. It doesn't go to poor people. It doesn't go to help anybody. What it does is it goes back into the system so the cops can go and arrest more people so they can get paid to go arrest more people, and then they get paid by them. And it's just this cycle where everybody ends up with a criminal record even though they haven't hurt anybody else, and the state just keeps raking in the dough. So the idea behind not taking a plea deal is that you kind of throw yourself into the gears of the system to some extent. There's risk involved because, yes, you can be sentenced stronger if you don't take the plea. But also, a lot of times, if you don't take the first plea deal, they'll come back at you with a better plea deal. So even if you want to take a plea, it's best to not take the first plea. So when they offer you the first plea, refuse it, and then it wouldn't surprise me if later they came back with, all right, well, how about a $100 fine instead of a $300 fine? Because they really, really want you to take the plea. They really don't want to have to do the work. They really don't want to have to go to court and make a case, which if you go all the way and you refuse their second plea deal, then you go to trial, and then you have the chance to see the evidence against you, which a lot of times is not very good. A lot of times they're just bluffing, and you'll win a case. A lot of cases they'll drop the charges before trial, right before trial. Oh, charges have been dropped. We've seen it happen, even with parking tickets. Something simple like a parking ticket. It's $5 for a parking ticket in Keene. Most people are going to pay a $5 ticket. I don't take the plea. Not guilty. I want my trial. And we've had people have parking tickets dropped because they just don't want to take the time and the effort to bring an attorney into court, bring the parking enforcers into court. By the way, every hour they're sitting in that courtroom, they're not on the streets writing tickets. So they don't want to do that stuff. They'll drop the charges, and there's a don't take a plea deal flyer in the back of the room. It's the very same flyer that I hand out at the courts. And I think I've summed that one up.
Yeah, the plea deal, the whole plea deal system that we have here is something that definitely turned me off to wanting to work in law enforcement, because it is just a human processing. It's like, you know, they're just farming money out of people for these things that aren't really hurting anybody. If the criminal justice system focused on crimes where there were victims, where somebody is harming someone else, I think it would have a major impact in reducing crime. I mean, like I said, New Hampshire isn't unfortunately plagued with crime the way other portions of the country are, but in other portions of the country, what I've seen, I was just in New Orleans, where they incarcerate more people per capita than anywhere else in the world. This is rivaling North Korea, Soviet Russia, China, all of these places where we're told that there's oppression. Right here in the United States are the places where more people are getting locked up than anywhere else. In those places, it definitely seems there's a targeted demographic. Down there, the jails are over 90% black, even though that does not represent the population demographics. And also, the jails and prisons in certain parts of the countries are being paid to maintain occupancy, which means it's their financial incentive to keep people in them. Which is a very scary prospect for the civilians in that area, people that are being targeted by a system that profits off of keeping them in a cage. Fortunately, we don't have that in New Hampshire. The prisons aren't operating at a profit off of individual inmates. But that is something that is an alarming trend. It's spreading to different parts of the country and something to be aware of. The plea deal process itself is something that, if you think of it, the idea that I said the courts aren't interested in truth, they're interested in processing. If they were interested in truth, if someone commits a crime, one should want there to be a full trial so that all of the evidence is analyzed and given an objective review, as opposed to the plea deal process, which potentially lets dangerous criminals off on something lighter than they should have gotten. So yeah, I see many issues with that, and I think it's definitely a good area for one to focus their activism.
While we're talking about the court system today, since most of these are good young people, good kids, they're never going to be on the wrong desk in a courtroom, but many of you will be called up as jurors early in your adult lives. So as long as you're 18, you can serve on a jury. And there's a process here here in New Hampshire called jury nullification that recently became codified in law. And it's a beautiful way for you all to be involved in having a very positive outcome. Ian can explain a little bit better how it works at the technical level. But keep in mind, you or your parents or your older siblings or cousins, they get called to be jurors, and now you'll have some information to share with them on something called jury nullification. What is that, Ian?
Well, we did not bring, unfortunately, the jury nullification flyers with us, but you can go to nhjury.com and you can learn more about this. But basically, something that they don't tell you when you become a juror is that you have the right to nullify a verdict. So normally when you're in a trial, the judge will give you what they call jury instructions, and the judge will say something like, you have to judge this case based on the facts in the case and the application of the law itself. And that's only half of the truth. The other half of the truth that they won't tell you is that you have the right to judge the law itself, meaning that if you are in a trial, let's say it's for the underage drinking, like a college student, she's 20, they caught her with a beer while she's walking to her friend's house, happens all the time in Keene. Let's say she goes to trial, you get called onto the jury, and you think that that's just a dumb law. That's just a law that just shouldn't be on the books because she didn't create a victim. Who was the victim? Well, you know, you should be able to do those things for yourself, right? So she didn't hurt anybody else. And so if you agree with me that that's a bad law, or maybe you think the war on drugs is insane and it's hurting your friends and your family members, either way, let's say they caught her red-handed. She had that beer in her hands. So like all the facts in the case are crystal clear. Like she broke that law. There's no doubt about it. But if you think the law is bad, then you can vote not guilty. As a juror, you can use your conscience and vote not guilty. And that's what jury nullification is. You are nullifying bad laws. They won't tell you about this. New Hampshire's the only state, as Mark mentioned, it was a fairly recent piece of legislation here in New Hampshire. New Hampshire's the only state where you can talk about jury nullification in a courtroom. If I was standing in that courtroom as a defendant, I would be able to tell you about jury nullification. But whether or not the attorney or the defendant tells you about jury nullification, you have the right to nullify. You have the right to use your conscience in any court case and judge, you know, you can say not guilty if you think the law itself is bad. You can ignore what the judge tells you. He will try to intimidate you into doing what he says. I mean, he's wearing a robe and he's sitting up higher than you are. So, you know, there's this religious aspect. Did you want
to
say something?
I wanted to add to that, yes. Jury nullification is not a new idea. It's a very old idea, something that our founding fathers spoke about. And it was used in the Peter Zenger case back in 1735, I believe. Mr. Coro would probably remember before I would. Because he was printing things against the government, and the government had him arrested, and it was England at the time, it wasn't even the United States, but it happened on our soil. Also, another case was the bad laws against the fugitive slave law, whereas if a slave escaped to New York or New Hampshire, we had to send them back to their state. So those two cases, jury nullification was used a lot. So it's not even an old idea. It's not a new idea. It's an old idea that is, personally, I think it's a good idea because it puts the onus on the people to nullify bad laws that a small group of people have passed.
Question?
Garrett, you and Ian have a very strong, I guess, word against what you believe about the war on drugs. Well, how do you feel about the Second Amendment and how they're trying to take away gun violence and everything?
I see the biggest threat to the Second Amendment being from the federal government, and under the guise of we're liberalizing drug laws across the country, therefore nobody's allowed to have guns anymore. Because right now the way that federal laws are written, guns are, if they're legal to the extent that they're legal, that's okay. But if somebody has some cannabis with somewhere near their gun, or even in the same house, that I believe is a federal issue, and you can have your guns stripped from you from being associated with drug use. Right now, there's no laws about guns and alcohol, other than you're not supposed to be carrying a firearm when you're drunk and things like that, of course. So that's the one threat I do see to the Second Amendment, is under the guise of cannabis laws are liberalizing, other drug laws may liberalize, so people can't have guns because they're allowed to have drugs. But other than that, if you live in a state where they're cracking down on it, of course, that's an issue. I don't see the Second Amendment or the federal constitution or the federal government is capable of protecting anything. I think individuals need to focus more on state and local level. In New Hampshire, we have Article 2A in the New Hampshire Constitution, which is much stronger in its protection of the individual right to bear arms than the federal constitution is. So to that extent, I'd say we're safe here, but that doesn't necessarily bode well for other parts of the country or the world.
I was going to say, remember, the government hates competition. The government is a monopoly in everything they do, and all monopolies don't like competition. So you'll see, you'll find government at the state level and the federal level always growing, always engaging in mission creep, trying to add more power, more scope, more cost to what it's doing. And I think it's smart to be a bit anti-authoritarian once in a while and push back. We need to do more of that.
I'm glad you asked that question. I think that as somebody who believes in liberty and your right to live your life how you want, so long as you don't harm anyone else, I think that means you also have the right to protect yourself. And whatever that means, whether it's guns, because the Second Amendment talks about bearing arms. So, you know, that could be more than guns. It could mean, you know, nunchucks or pepper spray or whatever it is you think is, you know, samurai sword, you know, whatever it is you feel helps you feel safe. I think that you should be free to do that, so long as you aren't threatening people with the weapon, as long as it's only there for your own personal defense or the defense of your family or your loved ones. I fully support your right. I support your right to possess anything that you want. You know, it's your body, it's your life, it's you. You should be free to do as you choose. Again, as long as there's no victim. And I think that the gun issue is interesting because there are a lot of parallels between, you know, sort of the war on drugs and the war on defense, the war on personal freedom to defend oneself. And I think that the interest groups are very distinct in those areas. You know, usually there's not a whole lot of crossover between the gun guys and the drug war people. But there really should be. They really should support each other. They should realize that this is all of these things we're talking about here is about your personal freedom. And one thing that's really important is that if you're not willing to stand up for the freedoms of someone else, maybe, you know, as a gun guy, you might not really feel like you can identify with somebody who wants to end the war on drugs. But if you can see them as being a group of people who's being persecuted, and if the people that want to end the war on drugs can see the gun owners as another group that's being persecuted, and if everybody can stand up for the rights of everybody else, then we'll have more freedom. But I think it was Pastor Martin Niemöller who in the World War II times is famous, and I'm going to paraphrase his famous poem now. He said, first they came for the communists, and I wasn't a communist, so I didn't stand up. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I wasn't a trade unionist, so I didn't stand up. And eventually they came for me, but there was no one else left to stand up at that point. So I think it's very important to identify that even though there may be people who do things you don't agree with, who like things that you don't that you don't like, who live in a different way than you would choose to live, that they should all be stood up for if their rights are being threatened. Do y'all have any other questions so far? Anybody got
anything?
You've already done one, so I want to make sure we get a chance. We can come back to you, but I just want to make sure everybody else gets a chance to ask a question if you have one. Yes, sir. Go ahead and say your name.
Trevor Parsons. Do you think people should be taught to be self-governed rather than governed by a government?
Great question. Ideally, we'd like your parents, or each person's parents, to teach them about self-governance, right? Everybody grows for the first 18 years of your life being governed by your parents, as it should be. But outside of that, we'd like to see that sort of education come from the home. We think that has the most impact. And yes, beyond that, definitely it'd be nice to have public schools and all type of secondary schools teach you about self-governance. It's just not going to happen, right?
It's, it, it,
What? They're run by the state, yeah. And they have compulsory attendance at these state-run schools, so I don't see that happening. But we can wish for it.
You know, you mentioned the compulsory attendance. There's a lady in Keene who came across the ideas of liberty and was had such an epiphany, she just decided that she was going to pull all of her kids out of the government schools and you know, bring them home and unschool them. So you might have heard of homeschooling. There's also something called unschooling, which is like a really, it seems like a really radical idea in schooling. Unschooling is where you aren't in a place like this. You would basically stay home and you could kind of do whatever you wanted to. You would direct your own learning. You would decide what you thought was the most interesting thing to learn. You would be the person who would be in charge of your curriculum and your education. You could seek out whatever experts and seek out whatever information that you wanted to. Anyway, she brought her kids out of the government school because she wanted them to make, you know, to have their own control over their education. And the state came after her for it. They came after her with negligence charges. And she, of course, didn't take the plea deal, thank goodness. And guess what? They dropped the charges before trial. So she's okay. They didn't, you know, they didn't stop her from doing it. But what they did try to do was intimidate her into bringing her kids back into the government schools by charging her with negligence. So I don't think that really answered your question. What was the question again?
Where do they learn self-governance?
Right. So learning self-governance, I mean, we all govern ourselves, obviously. I mean, you got here today on your own volition. You could have gone somewhere else had you wanted to. I think that responsibility, personal responsibility, is a really important thing. And the more that we can imbue young people with the sense of personal responsibility for their lives, that's really important. To look to the state for any kind of solution is a mistake. The state fails at almost everything that it tries to do. And even if it does accomplish something, even if it does, you know, manage to build a school or build a road or something like that, it still hasn't done it in an affordable manner. It hasn't done it in an efficient manner. And that's because the state can just count on money coming in year after year because your parents are all being threatened if they're homeowners, if they don't pay the property tax bill that comes in. Men with guns will show up to their home 3 or 4 years later after they've gotten a bunch of threatening letters from the state. And they will come and they will forcibly remove you from your home. And then you'll be homeless. And everybody knows that. You know, everybody who's a property taxpayer knows ultimately that there's a threat of violence behind what they're doing. And I think that anytime you have to threaten somebody with violence, it's proof you've got a bad idea, that your system is broken and you're doing it the wrong way. If you've got a good idea, people come on board. You've got something that people appreciate. People want to get, you want to get to where you want to go. People like roads. Roads are a good idea. It wouldn't be hard to fund roads or schools or whatever without the threat of violence. But the state has always had violence behind it. And I think that's one of the key points that I think we'd all three of us would like to see change.
I think to a large extent, self-governance is discouraged or disincentivized by the system we all grow up through, whether it's through the schools, through the legal system. It isn't like there's a point at which one is treated as a free adult. There's 17, 16 you can drive, 17 you can go to R-rated movies, 18 you get a few more privileges, 21 you can drink, 25 you can rent a car. It doesn't seem like there's a clear point at which people's decisions are respected. There's just an arbitrary amount of time up to which you'll be treated as a criminal for possessing alcohol, and then magically at midnight one day, it's totally okay and funds aren't invested in attacking you. So maybe if things are more streamlined, it would be easier for people to understand self-governance, but I think information's gonna help with that.
Here we go.
What did you mean by when you said you defeated a 20-year-old veteran or something like that? What did you mean by that?
Oh, that was probably myself. There was a 20-year incumbent in the state house who had that seat for a very long time. And myself and a few other people who ran against her in the primary, we got more votes than she did, and she was outed for that. We didn't take her seat. It was filled by one of our somebody running against us, but we did unseat her.
We actually thought you meant like a real veteran.
Oh, like military veteran.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks for the question.
My name's Nate, and you said nonviolence, like you don't support that. How else would you get people to do what you want without that? I mean, truly, like, you can't really take many more things away from people to get them to do what you want.
Oh,
Well, I guess that's the society is structured on that at the moment. I mean, I don't know when exactly the state came into being that there was an organization that would claim to fill social functions in the name of everyone. But the people alive today, if we consider the Constitution the start of this country, there's a great essay called The Constitution of No Authority by someone named Lysander Spooner. It was written in 1860. And it goes down to the idea of social contract being an agreement between people. And the Constitution that we have today was, at best, an agreement between the people alive at the time of its formation. So right now, it isn't like anyone alive today said, yes, I want to be a part of this system. But everybody still acts as though the system is very real and they pay their taxes and everything else. So to me, I think I'd like to move beyond a system that's based on coercion and based on the threat of if you don't pay, you're going to jail, and instead be voluntary, and if you don't pay, we just won't provide you the service. So to me, I think for many people to realize that the violence inherent in the system, I think many people just block it out, kind of ignore it. But yeah, like Ian said, anybody who pays their property taxes has to know I'm doing this under a certain coercive structure.
Mark, what do you think about that question?
There are a number of approaches, and we look at voluntary actions among people as the best way to conduct your daily life. And in fact, most people out there, that's how they do their lives. In the morning, you guys get up, take a shower, come to school, either take the bus or walk, or your parents give you a ride. Your parents go to work, they work, they're productive to earn a paycheck. All this is done voluntarily. Nobody has a knife at their back to do it. They're doing it because they want to do it. Then they go to the grocery store and they buy goods and food that was produced 1,000 miles away. It was trucked out here either on trains or on trucks or flown out by all people acting voluntarily without coercion. So that's the way society runs. I think we have too many rules right now in place. You do need some rules. Typically in a large society, the larger it gets, the more you need. But I think there are ways of conducting that with fewer penalties than we have nowadays. The problem is when laws are made, they're basically one size fits all regulations. And the problem is that there's no way to know exactly how 1.3 million people in New Hampshire are going to behave, or 320 million people in the United States are going to behave. You can't make a rule to apply to every single last one of them. It just doesn't work. So I think more liberty is what we deserve as a species and as a race in this country. And I'm looking forward to pushing towards that direction as much as we can.
I want to thank you for the question. It's a good one. It kind of brings me back to something I touched on before. Your question was basically, how do you get people to do what you want without the threat of violence? And the answer is persuasion, incentive. If you have something that's a good idea, people are going to come on board. It's no problem. You're going to be able to get people to agree with you if it's persuasive. If you can incentivize people in certain ways, you know, whatever that might mean, like you want to go to school, well, you want to learn something, well, here's what you can do. People are going to have a drive to improve themselves. So incentivizing things that you want people to do is important, disincentivizing things that you don't want them to do, and incentivizing and disincentivizing them without violence, without turning to the threat of putting somebody in a cage or the threat of physically harming them. So again, as I said before, if you've got a good idea, people are going to come on board with it. The hallmark of a bad idea is that you have to threaten people. So just leave violence out as an option, and then start getting creative on how you can actually achieve what it is that you want to do.
I have a quick question for you, Mr. Caro. So I was just wondering, if you don't tax people to pay for roads, and someone wants to use the road that hasn't paid, what are you going to do to stop them from using it?
Well, again, I'm not interested in enforcing a view on anybody. And the roads is a good question. It's a tough question because we're so used to roads being created by the state. So what would it look like in a world without coercion, in a world without the threat of violence being behind these roads? And there are a lot of different answers to that question that we could possibly throw out there. One thing we can't know is exactly how that would work, but I can throw out some ideas. Like, for instance, business owners have a very serious interest in getting customers to their business, right? So, you know, a road could possibly be sponsored by the business owners that are on that road, for instance, to make sure that their customers have easy access. There's obviously the possibility of advertising on the roads. It's not necessarily, I think toll roads are an old bad idea, but tolls are a possibility. I don't think that tolls will end up being the way that that is operated, because I think they're very inconvenient, and businesses on those roads are going to want convenience for their customers. So if you can get the road sponsored by billboards or some sort of sponsorship dollars, that's an option. And then also, again, just maybe the business owners would just foot the cost of handling that. What do you think, Garrett?
With technology, I don't think that tolls are necessarily going to go away. In fact, we may see more toll roads that are based on some sort of transponder. But I'd like to see these more be entities that are not within the government for their toll roads doing it. If it was a private development, I think it would be much more efficient, because the Easy Pass system, there are a few states that accept it, but it still creates very much of a traffic jam. Even where you do have an Easy Pass, people are still backed up because you got to go a certain slow speed through it. I would love to see roads get more efficient, less intersections, and more constant flow. But that's something that requires space, and I think communities are able to solve these issues themselves. The people who live on a certain road have an interest in it being plowed and an interest in it not having potholes. When I was just in Louisiana driving around in New Orleans, there were potholes everywhere, the roads were in terrible condition, and that was a place where people just accept that there's corruption and that certain projects aren't going to be properly paid for and done. And people, I'd say if there were potholes here, I in fact know of a few people who have filled potholes themselves just out of interest in not having to want to drive down a road that's going to ruin their shocks and struts. So, you know, that is one of those issues. The road's a bigger one where it would be nice to look at a better way of doing it that meets everyone's interests and still everyone can chip into.
What do you say? We got one back.
On the issue of unschooling, I taught for 15 years, and so I'm very passionate about teaching. And I had family members who homeschooled. If society decides that unschooling is an answer and kids are not educated correctly so that they cannot go get jobs, then it's going to be society's responsibility to pay food stamps and unemployment for those kids that can't get jobs because they were unschooled instead of getting the kind of education that they need in order to be successful.
Sure, this is the old objection to not having kids in government school, the idea that, well, there are some parents who don't care about their kids. And that's certainly true, and that's certainly a concern. But those parents are an issue whether you've got government schools or not. And in that case, it has to be the people that know those children, who take an interest in their lives and take an interest in helping them learn, even when it seems like their parents don't have that interest. You know, when you actually look at homeschoolers and unschoolers, they're some of the smartest kids out there. At least that's been my experience in knowing them. And certainly, you know, look at the spelling bee, for instance, every year with a national spelling bee, it's almost always a homeschooled student that nails that. So I get the concern, but the fear about what some parents might do, to me, isn't justification for using the threat of violence against them. And ultimately, that's what happens if you don't send your kids to the government school, or you don't give them some sort of plan, you know, give them something to approve, then men with guns come, and then your parents get arrested. Now, they might have been bad parents before, but now they're not even there anymore. So I don't think violence makes that situation better. I don't think the threat of violence makes that situation better. And ultimately, that's what's behind government compulsory schooling. Now, to say that we have a free market in education doesn't mean there wouldn't be schools. Obviously, a lot of people value the idea of having kids together in one place. But what we could have in that case would be different schools that focus on different things. I think unschooling is an interesting idea, but it may not be right for every student, in the same way that being in this school may not be right for every student either, because the government system is a one-size-fits-all solution. And a lot of people get left behind because of that, and that's not the intention. I think teachers really care. Every teacher I've ever known really cares about their students, and they really want what's best for them. I was talking with a high school student recently who was pointing out a lot of the wasted time that happens in school. For instance, where you're forced to take classes you're not really interested in because, well, that's the way it is. When was the last time you used algebra in your life?
Well, I guess you use the idea of placeholders, but yeah, I'm pulling out a calculator.
I remember when I was in school, they were like, well, you won't always have a calculator with you? Really? Well, we have calculators now, and they're in all of our pockets, probably, so that excuse doesn't work anymore. And I was pretty decent at math when I was in school, but I haven't used it as an adult. So what if all these young people who are in these classes they're not interested in could focus on things they are interested in, focus their time and their effort on that and build themselves in those areas? I think we'd have even more useful people in the job market that way, because then they could do things more productively and really zero in on the things that are most important to them. What do you think, Mark?
I think that's true. And in any kind of vacuum, you have a lot of innovation that takes place to replace that vacuum or that missing entity. So if all of a sudden there were fewer government schools or public schools, then you'd have more private schools pop up. You would actually have businesses or industries start schools. What we're finding now is a lot of employers are complaining that people right out of high school don't have some of the skills they need to do some of the work at those companies. So let's say companies band together and offer training that is more specific to their particular industries. That way people would get out of those schools and they immediately have some sort of employment. So I think we need more creative approaches and more freedom in the provision of education, and you'll have 1,000 or 1,000,000 different more opportunities and better outcomes, ultimately, probably at a lower cost as well.
I think technology is something that really opens up the gates for what we'll be able to do in the near future, because right now it's not necessary that everyone be in one room to hear one person. People could remotely conference, people could remotely network with one another, and the information is freer than ever. The curriculum's out there. You don't need to pay to go to college anymore if you really wanted to learn the information you would get in college. Now, there's still value, I guess, in the degree for some people and the experience. But information freedom is something, I'm a big fan of information freedom. I upload everything, or all of the work that I produce is Creative Commons, which means I'm not claiming copyright. And I'd love to see more people, and we continue to see more people, creating content that is Creative Commons for all people to share and use and disseminate. And that definitely opens up a lot of doors for us.
On the option of unschooling, if it was an option, how do you think the government would decide whether whoever was unschooled has the learning that would require for college if they had the interest in going to college? How would the government decide whether he had the intelligence to go to college with him being unschooled?
Sure, that's a good question. And the fact is that I don't think it's up to the government to decide whether that person has the skills. The colleges all have their entrance exams. You have the SATs and the ACTs. In a new world where you had fewer people going to public schools, you had more people being homeschooled, that you'd have all sorts of alternative testing measures and maybe in-person interviews, to go to a college. And you could certainly provide your detailed personal portfolio as to the skills you have at the end of your equivalent of a high school degree. And so we're seeing that happen already, even in the absence of that.
I like what Garrett pointed out, that there's a lot of college curriculum that you can just go online and learn. You don't necessarily need to go after the piece of paper, this degree, which I think is highly overrated. And I went to college for 2 years and it was a waste of my time and money. I think that if you don't know exactly what you want to do, you shouldn't go to college right out of high school. You really should consider it seriously, especially if you're going to be paying for it. If somebody else is paying for college, then well, go for it. Have fun. But if you're going to end up with $30,000, $50,000, $70,000, $100,000 in debt, and then all you have to show for it is a piece of paper, do the research out there. You'll find so many stories of young people in their 20s who have a huge load of debt that they have to pay off, and they've got a job as a server at a restaurant, or they're working at some $10 an hour retail job, and they're so disappointed in their experience because, you know, they went to college and got a communications degree or some other, you know, degree in whatever they thought was cool, but it turns out that it wasn't very useful for them to get a job. So I'd be very, very cautious. There's a real heavy push, especially when it's when you're your age, there's a heavy push from people in education to keep continuing on with this. And I support education. Like I said, you can go out and educate yourself as much as you want. We have the internet today, and lots of college curriculum is there. You can take the very same college curriculum for free and get all of the learning without necessarily having their little piece of paper at the end. And then you've got all your money in your pocket, and rather than having $50,000 in debt. We're about done, right? How many more minutes? 2 minutes?
I just have to bring my class questions
in. Do we have time for a closing statement from these folks? All right.
All right. Well, yeah. Thanks again, everybody, for coming down here. I hope that, like, we've kind of provided a little bit of an alternative for people, like things that you can do yourselves to, if you see an issue or if there's something that's important to you, to either gain attention to or to get more minds on and more people thinking about it. Cameras are always getting cheaper. Laptops are always getting cheaper. Editing video isn't hard. Editing articles, posting them isn't hard. So I'd encourage people to take advantage of the times we live in and make objective records of the world around you to make it a better world.
Yes, thank you for coming by today. And don't forget, we do have the stuff on the table on the way out there. There's some really interesting flyers. Please help yourselves. I don't care if we go back with no flyers. We've got hundreds more back in Keene. So don't take a plea deal information there. Also, there's a great warning flyer from Cop Block, from Keene Cop Block, which is all about knowing your rights. So if you don't know your rights, or even if you think you know your rights, when it comes to dealing with the police, you really should take that flyer if you get a chance, right back there on the table. And again, you can find me at freetalklive.com. That's my radio show. I also blog at freekeen.com. So if you want to learn more about some of the stuff we're doing, those are two great websites to do that.
Thank you for attending and appreciate your interest today. You can start doing informational education on your own now and do some investigation research online on things that are working for liberty, and let's push back a little bit against big government and start exercising our liberty more here at home. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
We'd like to invite you to visit freekeen.com. Freekeen.com features audio, video, and blogs chronicling the transition to a voluntary society. Freekeen.com also has comments and discussion forums so you can be heard. Freekeen.com.
I should be in Keene, New Hampshire with the Free Staters.